What is up, everyone? Welcome to the newest installment of Friday Night Wars, the hottest sports debate show on YouTube today. And Joe Morley hasn't said a word in the intro yet, and there's a reason for it. It's because someone has successfully gone back to back to back. And this is my victory speech from my victory last week. Joe, I saw you brought out the Joe Morley gang. Everyone showed up, and it was a tough mountain to climb. But the second that I called out to the Mike and the Mike squad like this, they came on and they voted, and we won 34-17. Doubled your score, Joe. Man, I feel really good today. It's been a great day. And instead of taking this time to tell you how much you absolutely suck, I'm going to go ahead and give my victory speech to the people that voted. So here is all 34 people that voted for Mike on the Mic last week on Friday Night Wars. Be sure to drop down and vote real quick right now. Who cares? You don't need to see it. You know who's going to win. Anyways, starting it off, Jeremiah, Jacob Burnett, Benny Cerna, Bobby Womper, Stephen Wagner, Plugged In With Jay, Rosanna, Luis Martinez, Luis Castaneda, Nick Payne, sorry if I butcher this, Ibrahim Manasare, hopefully I didn't butcher it. I know I did butcher it. Duke Michaels, Elijah James, Fanatic Films, Viv the Vikings Fan, Kayla Wilson, Grant Hogan, It's Grant, Andrew Orlena, Christian Macias, Matthew Resendez, Christian Stuyvesant, Lacey Jane, CGL Theo, Jonah Berman, Ernesto Abayotes, hope I didn't butcher that too, I probably did, Tom Lauren, Young Arrow, Dion Moore, Damit, Rosemary Archilla Michaels, Helen Archilla, Jonathan Castaneda, Real the Goat, Jake Young, Marone G, and Matthew Levine. Thank you for voting. Let's get into it, Joe.
Let's get ready to rumble.
Step into the war zone.
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 Friday night war zone.
Friday night war zone.
Hey yo, it's Phil Flames. I'm with Mike on the mic and Joe Morley. About to bring you more heat. Welcome to the war zone. You can have a floor seat. Watch him on your iPhone. Watch him on your Galaxy. It's a sports debate show. Shade up by the SoCal. Gather around the laptop. Friday nights it goes down. And we on the radio. Coming to your locale. Got into the third round. Better bring the smoke now.
Step into the war zone.
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 Friday night war zone.
Friday night war zone.
Step into the 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 war zone.
Friday night war zone.
Friday night war zone.
I try to hold my breath the whole time you're talking because that's how much I cared. I was going to be willing to give up my own life to not listen to you because you're so boring and I don't know why 34 people voted for you. Like, they don't even watch the show. They must not even watch the show and just hop. I saw one lady hop on and be like, Mike, I want grandbabies. That's not even, did you count that as a vote? Is that a vote?
No, I didn't count that as a vote, but that was me trying to get someone to vote. Yes, that was my mother-in-law.
Mike, you had, how many videos did you have to make to get all these, the 34 people to come vote?
I didn't really have to make any videos. I just made a video on TikTok and said, hey guys, go and vote because Joe sucks.
Joe sucks.
Because freaking Mr. Cat is voting for him.
Look, check this out, Mike. It's great to have all those people come. It's great. But they ain't loyal. They're not subscribing. They're not going in there hitting that subscribe button and saying, yeah, we love Mike. They ain't watching this. They're just going to vote for Mike. Once they become loyal listeners, once they become subscribers, and I actually have a little bit of respect for them, respect for the Mike on the Mic followers, because right now they have none from me. Once they become those loyal, they'll find out and they actually start watching the show more and more, they're going to fall in love. Because haters want it over here at the Joe Morley Sports. Haters want it. But watch out, because you will fall in love.
Well, I will say this, Joe. What was it, like 3 weeks ago now? During that two-week hiatus, I did some recruiting, bringing some more Mike and the Mike Squad members over here. We were a little bit outnumbered. That's why you were on such a hot streak before. And since then, I'm pretty sure you can quote me out and go check and call me out if I'm wrong. But I think every week since then, the Mike and the Mike Squad has broken the record for the most votes in the comment. I'm pretty sure. I'm pretty sure it was like 20 something last week and like 18 before, 19 before. So, hey, I think they're sticking around and multiplying and growing each week.
How much do you pay Jay the Plug to vote for you?
I don't pay anything, actually. Jay the Plug knows you stink.
Such a kiss butt. Like, he'll kiss your butt till the end of the day. I got all the, you know, Warzone Sports Network guys, come on out. You guys pick your side now. I want Tony Tucker. I want Brian Bolstered Up Sports, Joe Skurdo, Nick Mac Daddy, Levi, Jay, we're not going to count Jay the Plug, Seven, Kevin Piggy Bank. Get on my side. Let's push Mike back down to where he belongs.
Now, Jay the Plug counts. Jay the Plug's in the war zone, one of the new additions to the war zone.
But his vote don't count because he's swayed every week by you.
How? What do I do to sway him? What do I have to offer to him that you don't have to offer to him?
If Jay votes for you again this week, it shows that he's jealous of my good looks.
Or maybe I just have a better argument for a topic.
Mike, I have a reset the topic. When people look at me, they say, that guy has it. When they look at you, they go, oh, type Mike in him. This poor dude.
What was it last week? Maybe Jay liked my Julio to the Chargers take. He probably did.
I doubt it.
Anyways, here we are. Welcome to Friday Night Wars once again. Banter's over. I'm ready to go to war. But first, if you guys can, if you're here, please take the 1 second to tap that subscription button and a little notification bell right next to it so you're alerted every time we drop a new video. This isn't just Friday Night Wars if you're new to the channel. We have 5 shows airing weekly and over 3 live streams. I'm going to say 3. I'm comfortable with saying guaranteeing you 3 or more live streams every single week here on the Warzone Sports Network. You want to be a part of something special before it becomes special and explodes? This is your chance right now, because this is going places. And I have to do it, you know, with my friend over here, Joe Morley, but I'm willing to pay the price for everyone at home.
And look at the 2 shirts that we have. We have Mike has the NWO inspired shirt, and we have this one, the Warzone. Hey, if you want to get those, warzonesportsnetwork.com.
Let's go to war. Has the Greek Freak found his killer instinct?
Michael. Is that your full name or is it microphone? I don't know what to call you. What does the mic stand for? Mic on the mic. I don't know if it's microphone on the mic or mic. I don't know. It's confusing. Anyways, it's a combination of both, right? But I think it's more that the Heat are very, very overrated and have been for a while. Some teams play above their talent level all the time, and this is just one of those times. This is another one of those times. A basketball player has never has to find his killer instinct. They either have it from the beginning or they never, ever have it. Trust me on that, Mike. Athletes are born that way. They have it, and you could tell when some guys are just going through the motions. So this is more that the Heat are not good, and they're not as good as advertised, and it's okay. And they will eventually get there where they need to be. It's kind of like the Clippers situation, right? It's all talk, no bite from the Heat. That's all. Everybody talks about it, but when it comes down to it, they ain't going to be about anything. The playoffs are where good teams weed out the bad teams. And unfortunately for the Heat, you're a bad team. So goodbye!
In game one, Giannis Antetokounmpo put up 26 points, 18 rebounds. You heard me right. 18 rebounds for a forward who is mostly carrying the ball. And 5 assists. In game two, 31 points, 13 rebounds, 6 assists. That, to me, when you look at those 2 stat lines, sounds like a man on a mission. Now, this is stuff that Giannis could do every single night if he absolutely wanted to. But in the playoffs, we've seen him kind of shrivel in. We've seen him kind of shrink. He isn't doing that thus far in this playoff series. He's doing what he does on offense. He's doing what he does on defense while hustling to get the boards. He's basically just taking over the game. And it's not just Giannis. Middleton hit the game winner in game one and dropped 17 of his own in game two. This Bucks team, to me, has a different feel than they've had in previous years. They look and they feel like they're playing with a chip on their shoulder. That chip is beginning to evolve. That chip is beginning to look like a killer instinct from the outside looking into me. And it's perfect timing to find it, because all of a sudden the East is extremely competitive. Keep balling, Greek Freak. I think the Bucks are legitimate contenders this year and in years coming if he has found that killer instinct.
Put it on the board for Joe Morley, round one. Won that one. That was easy. Let's move on.
You just came in here and said that you just came in here and said that last. You want to do it one more time? I'll let you do it one more time.
Do what?
That's what you're going to do it right there. What? Last year's Eastern Conference champions. You're saying they suck now. They're trash.
Yes.
No. No, I think that the Bucks are stepping it up. This is kind of revenge for them, too, because the Heat is who eliminated them last year. And last year, I think, was the Bucks' best chance at going all the way. Because the bubble and everything that was going on, the Eastern Conference was weak. The Nets really didn't exist. The 76ers weren't as good as they are now. It was the Bucks' conference to win, and the Heat completely ruined it for them.
So who overplayed last year? The Heat. Who underplayed last year? The Bucks. Now the Bucks are back to where their level is, and the Heat are still overrated. Right? You just said that.
I'm not saying that the Heat overperformed. The Heat were a really good team last year. They were on a freaking fire. They're not overrated. This is a legitimate team that could still win this series. Like, they could go 4-2, win four straight games. They do
get
stuff
the chant
like
going,
that.
Mike. Get the chant going. Overrated. Overrated.
It's also only been two games, so it's like a little bit too soon. Let's see what the Bucks do versus the Brooklyn Nets, or let's see what the Bucks do versus the 76ers. If they keep stepping up the way they've been stepping up, then I'm willing to say that Giannis and this entire Bucks roster that's been very good for about 5 years now has finally found it, finally found that killer instinct that we're talking about here. All right, guys, let us know. It's three straight, so, I mean, we're starting to get out of a fluke territory here.
Mike, we've been here before.
I'm actually in the lead. I didn't even bring that up. I'm in the lead for the first time since, like, week one, I think.
It's actually four straight wins.
Is it? Oh, yeah, because I won the one before the two-week hiatus. So thanks, Joe. I have the lead for the first time. Anyways, let's move on. I already did my trash talk. I already did my speech. Let's move on to the next round. Let us know who you think won this round in the comment section below, or just take a little note and let us know who won overall at the end of the show. Be sure to drop a comment. Smash the like button for the algorithm. Let's move on to the next one. Can the Packers go above 500 with Jordan Love? Yo, Jordan Love played a total of zero. That's right. Zero snaps last year. Jordan Love had a turnover problem in college, most likely the reason that he slid so far in the first place. Remember, there was talks of him being selected inside of the top 10 with the three quarterbacks that were that year in the 2019 draft, and he just slid all the way back out until the Packers had to trade it up into the 20s to get him. And another story that hasn't gotten much attention that I think should get attention, along with all-time great, that bad man Aaron Rodgers, Green Bay wide receivers Devontae Adams, might recognize the name, MVS, Alan Lazard, and St. Brown all have not shown up and are no-shows to voluntary OTAs. Now, it is voluntary. The name voluntary is in front of that word. But you'd think if there's a chance, and it's starting to look like a high chance, that you will be basically playing with a rookie quarterback who has zero snaps of experience instead of Aaron frickin' Rodgers as you originally planned, your entire receiver core would show up to work on things like chemistry, to work on things like flow, to work on things like the playbook and just what they like to do on the field that Aaron Rodgers already knows like the back of his hand. Jordan Love doesn't know any of this stuff. On top of it all, the Packers see that Chicago defense twice a year and up-and-coming Vikings teams twice a year. I mean, this topic should be whether or not Jordan Love is going to get out of Chicago alive, let alone have a winning season this season as the Packers quarterback. As far as I'm concerned, the pieces in Green Bay got worse this offseason, and now you turn one of the biggest question marks in NFL history and what's going on with the Aaron Rodgers situation and whether or not he's coming back, and you try and tell me that they're going to win 9 games this year. They got to win 9 now to go above 500. This is an awful situation, and Jordan Love is not set up for success in 2021.
Mike, Jordan Love has a lot of hate on him for some reason. I understand that the Packers shouldn't have drafted him because they had other needs, and they have Aaron Rodgers, right? I get it. But coming out of college, people loved Jordan Love and actually knew that he was going to be a developmental quarterback. But that they also knew that if you wanted Jordan Love, you had to take him in the first two rounds. more than likely first round, because some are even talking about, remember on draft day, him going top 10, there was like rumors out there that he could be floating everywhere. Jordan Love has a lot of potential, but he also turns the ball over a lot, right? And that's what we saw in college. Matt LaFleur with Jordan Love as the starter will change his offense, will change his system, put Love in great positions to succeed. Mike, have you seen A.J. Dillon? Have you seen A.J. Dillon compared to Aaron Jones? They just showed a picture of him from training camp. He's huge. That dude is huge. You know what they're going to do? They're going to go back to the Tennessee offense that LaFleur used to run. Green Bay is going to run it. They're going to run the ball. They're going to hand that ball off to Dillon all day. So Love will have some growing pains, but that good defense and that good running game will help Love overcome a lot of the problems. Not to mention, that division sucks. That division, the Vikings, the Lions, the Bears. Yeah, right. Come on, Mike. Jordan Love, you know what? Hashtag Love 2022.
Laughable, Joe. Laughable. You're out here. Compare A.J. Dillon's legs to Aaron Jones, right? Let's talk about Aaron Jones's contract compared to A.J. Dillon. They could have gotten a guy undrafted, and they drafted him with a second round pick, an early second round pick instead, as a backup running back.
I don't know if you saw my Twitter. Put a picture of both.
What's your Twitter? Plug your Twitter real quick.
Joe Morley Sports on Twitter. Check it out. But I retweeted a picture that the Packers put out, and it's Dillon and Jones standing on the sideline. And I said, A.J. Dillon's thighs are carrying this dude's contract, Aaron Jones's contract. Because it reminded me of the old picture of Derrick Henry and Deion Lewis. Remember that picture?
Yep.
That's the big size difference. I don't know. I think that I don't know why they gave Aaron Jones the money they did. They should have let him go and let A.J. Dillon just take over already. But they kept him. But they know that Aaron Rodgers is on the way out in Green Bay. They already know that. Either it's this year, next year, he's done. Davante Adams, more than likely gone at the end of this year as well. So Green Bay is going to have a lot of changes, but I think they're going to go more run-based. And that's what that whole division does anyways.
Yeah, I actually like that take that they might go of a more run-first offense. But in this NFL, in today's NFL, you got to step back and throw it at some point. And Jordan Love is going to have to step back on a 3rd-and-7 and complete a pass to extend a drive. Can he do that? No idea. No one has any clue, because I don't think he even suited up for games last year. Did he even suit up? Is that your sponsor coffee? Is that your personal coffee?
Joe Morley coffee. It's great.
Joe Morley coffee. There you go, guys. You can start selling on the website soon. But yeah, I like that take. I love A.J. Dillon, by the way. There's a story about him, you know, early on in the NFL season where there was these guys, their buddy was overseas in the military, huge Packers fan, and they actually got him an A.J. Dillon jersey and hit up A.J. Dillon, I think on TikTok or maybe it was on Twitter. And A.J. Dillon responded and met up with them and signed the jersey and everything to get it out, which is pretty cool.
It sucks. Like, you can't replace Aaron Rodgers. You can't replace him. And Jordan Love is going to make the mistakes. Yes, people make mistakes. Not everybody can, you know, not throw 20 interceptions over a course of 5 seasons. Aaron Rodgers is up here, and you're going to take a step back. But I think they're good enough, and the division is bad enough that they could at least win 9 games.
I don't think so, man. I don't think so. I think that they're going to be in trouble versus Chicago when they have to see that defense, because they'll stop the run and make him pass.
And you got to remember, he can run the ball too.
Yeah, if he can move around, I mean, who knows? He might come out and be really good for all we know. But to me, the question mark, the fact that he wasn't even the backup last year, leads me to bet on the latter, that he's not going to win them 9 games. He's not going to be amazing.
Where's Jordan Love
from? He has to be amazing. Yeah, he has to be amazing to do this.
You know where Jordan Love's from?
Where is it? Bakersfield?
Bakersfield, California's hotspot. And only great people, great athletes, great all-around specimens come from Bakersfield, California.
Let's move on to the next round. Only thing that's in Bakersfield is dirt. It's probably a freaking, what are those things called? The Ferris wheel. It's probably a Ferris wheel and dirt. That's it, huh?
Yeah, when the fair comes.
All right, let us know what you guys think. Jordan Love, 9 games. Over under is basically the concept here. I'm going under. Joe's going over. What are you guys doing? Let us know. Team Mike or Team Joe in the comment section below. Smash that like button, by the way. All right, let's move on to the next topic. What is more impressive, Tom Brady winning a Super Bowl age 42 or Phil Mickelson winning a PGA championship at age 50?
Really? 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 That's my inner Miz right there. You know the Miz. Are we really asking this, Mike? Is this like really, this really made a Friday Night Wars debate? Tom Brady winning at 42. This is football. It's not, it's football, golf, Mike. Golf is very highly debated on if it's actually a sport. If it's actually a sport, and we want to talk about Phil Mickelson and Tom Brady, which one's more impressive? Come on, Mike. Mickelson could take his time and tee off while everybody has to shut the heck up. Shh, shh. This guy's going to hit the ball as far as he can. Shh, shh. While Tom Brady says hike, and he has 4 to 5 300-pound guys running straight at him, trying to hurt him. Mickelson's hardest time of the day is when his ball gets put in some taller grass. It's a little bit taller. Oh, that's rough. And maybe it goes into a little sandbox and he has to hit it out. Oh, man, he has to put on, you know, grab another club. This has to be a joke of a topic, Mike. There's no possible case that you can make against Tom Brady and the sport of football being tougher than golf. Like, come on. I mean, old people in their 90s still play golf, Mike. In their 90s, when's the last time you saw a 90-year-old pick up a football and toss it around or run a fade route? Huh? You ever seen that, Mike? You ever seen that? Probably not, right? Probably not. Tom Brady winning is impressive, and that's coming from me. And you know it's hard for me to give Brady any credit, right? It's hard for me to do it. If anyone sides with you on this topic, Mike, if they decide to go with you on this topic and let you win this whole thing, I really have to start questioning the sports knowledge of the fans and the followers that watch this show because, wow.
Mic drop, huh?
Got him. Coach.
All right, Joe. I understand. I have the tough task of convincing everyone at home that Phil Mickelson's performance in golf was more impressive than Tom Brady winning a Super Bowl at home. In the first year being with a new team in 20 years with brand new receivers and everyone they never worked with before and the new head coach who has his own ego. So yeah, I have to try and convince you that that was not as impressive as this, but I have a little bit of a point because look, I understand the nature of football is a lot tougher, but it's Brady. He takes one, maybe two hits a game at the max, maybe five if he's playing a good defensive line. And I'm not trying to take away from Brady either. I think he's the greatest sports player ever. I dance around my words there. I don't want to say athlete because there's been a better athlete than him ever, but the best sports player ever, most successful for damn sure. Anyways, Phil Mickelson is 50, talking about old age. That's the big 5-0. To put that into perspective, Joe, I am 23 years young. You know that. Now all the viewers know that at home. Realistically, at 23, mid-20s, I can have a kid, right? My parents could be grandparents right now. Both of my parents are not even within 5 years of turning 50. This is a literal grandpa going out and competing against and schooling young cats in a sport that takes a ton of dedication. I mean, he's got decades of dedication into this, decades of consistency and drive. See what I did there? Pun intended. If Brady wins a Super Bowl at 50, I've changed my answer. Mickelson's chip was more impressive. At least that's my argument for it being more impressive.
You know what? The only thing that's impressive is that his hip doesn't pop out. He doesn't break a hip because what did Happy Gilmore say? It's all in the hips. Yeah. Huh? It's all in the hips. That's the only thing. Like, come on, dude. Like, 42 years old playing football, running, throwing at a high level. It doesn't matter if you only get hit once or twice a game. You're getting hit. You're getting hit. Yeah, I don't even know why we're debating this.
So you're turning this more into a golf versus football thing. I'm talking about this Mickelson purely being in the PGA in the first place at age 50 and then winning it all, winning a championship. That's impressive. When we couldn't go out there and hit a golf ball. I couldn't even hit a golf ball, I don't think.
When people get hurt in other sports, you know what other athletes do during their downtime. You know what basketball players, football players do? They play golf. You know what presidents do on their downtime? They play golf. It's a leisure activity that anybody, any age can play. It's not competitive at all. So it's not impressive to me. It's not impressive.
Well, what it sounds like to me is that there's probably millions and millions and millions of more people to compete with in the sport of golf than there is in the sport of football. That's what I kind of just heard you say. There's a lot more competition.
Everybody can play golf. Not everybody can play at the NFL level.
Yeah, well, everybody does play golf. So there's much more people playing golf, competing to be the best golfer in the world, and Phil Mickelson at age 50. There's only so many, you know, 53-man rosters, 32 teams. Y'all do the math. I don't know if that even breaks 5,000 football players. Does that even break 1,000 football?
You're saying I can go down to Dick's Sporting Goods right now. Dick's Sporting Goods, brought to you by the Warzone Sports Network. No, I don't know. I'm just joking. If you want to sponsor it, hit us up. But anyway, I can go down to Dick's Sporting Goods, buy me a club right now, and all of a sudden, I'm a competitor against Phil Mickelson. That's what you're saying right now.
No, I'm saying that if more people can easily get into golf, then he has more competition. There's more golfers out there. I'm not saying that you would compete with anybody in any sport.
Yeah, because I'll any sport that I pick, I dominate.
I would dunk on you. Just bam, hang from the rim.
If coach would have put me in senior year, we would have won state.
Should have put you in. Should have put you in.
Good old Uncle Rico.
What position did you play? Did you play receiver, quarterback?
I could throw this ball over that mountain over there.
Make it look easy. You should actually be in the NFL as a quarterback. No! You should switch positions to tight end.
Yeah, if I was going to come back to the NFL, it'd be tight end because apparently everybody's going to tight end.
Yeah, and it works too. Everyone's getting in.
Who's going to be a better tight end, Mike? A little bit off topic here. Benjamin or Tebow?
Benjamin.
Yeah, I think so too.
And I defended Tebow like last week or the week before. I'm really defending the fact that like he just has the connections and that's how he got in there. Not that I think he's going to be a good tight end. I think Kelvin Benjamin, he actually has like skills of running routes and being a receiver and stuff. Now, the blocking, I'm not sure, but Tebow doesn't have any blocking experience either.
Oh, you mean he has the actual skills to play in the NFL at a position that needs to catch?
Yeah, I don't know if you remember, Kelvin Benjamin's a big dude. Like, he was huge. Yeah. He had potential. He just got too big, it seemed like.
He just went on the Joe Morley diet.
That's what ended up happening to him. Same thing as Eddie Lacy. You remember Eddie Lacy?
Yeah, it's not funny.
Yeah, I think it was pretty funny. Anyway,
that was good.
you ready to close this thing out?
Yeah, let's get out of here.
All right, give your last plugs, give your last shout outs, make your last pitch.
Guys,
it's been bad for you.
If you ain't voting for Joe, then you a hoe.
Yeah, guys, vote for Joe. All right, just right now, type in Joe. Because you almost made me spit my drink right there all over this table. Anyways, go check out www.warzone.com. www.warzone.com.
Warzone. www.warzonenetwork.com.
Oh. Warzonesportsnetwork.com. I'm leaving all of this in. WarzoneSportsNetwork.com. Check us out at the Warzone Sports Network on all social media platforms. I think it's just Warzone with two S's on Twitter. So that's a little tweak. But if you search Warzone Sports Network, I'm sure the page will come up. We're on all platforms now. We're getting active on Twitter, TikTok, Instagram, and everything in between. Facebook, everything. So just go ahead and go check us out. Monster does not sponsor us before he goes ahead and says that.
Monster, hit us up.
Yeah, hit us up. We're taking sponsorships right now. Oh, man. And if you don't vote for Joe, you're a hoe. All right. Even if you are a hoe, you could use this advice. This simple, easy advice. And that is that if you're ever talking sports or in a sports debate that you never know when you're going to have to go to war.